Hi, you are live with Growing Generations. We're actually in West Virginia, which is where our other office is. Joining me today is Stephanie in our egg donation program. So, just like some of our other past live videos that we've done, and I've talked a little bit about surrogacy in general, we're going to talk today about being an egg donor. So, thank you for joining me
Sure, no
today.
problem. Thanks for
Yeah,
having
we were
me.
actually doing a staff retreat earlier, so this worked out perfectly. Oh, hey, hi, Val. I
Hi,
see we
Val.
already have some people joining. Hello. So, we'll just kind of get started. So, for people out there who maybe think that maybe they would like to be an egg donor, or maybe they know that, they have a cousin who's absolutely beautiful, or, a granddaughter who's as smart as a whip. Where would they get started?
So your first step would be to visit our website. So it's growinggenerations.com, and up at the top you'll click Be an Egg Donor. You'll find a ton of information about egg donation, as well as our program, as well as the application, which is going to be your first step. So with the application, it is mobile friendly. It's going to take you anywhere from 20 to 30 minutes, and we'll need some health information from you as well as your family health history. So make sure you have all of that information available when you're filling out your application.
Awesome. And if you didn't have that with you, are you able to kind of walk away from it and come
You
back or?
can,
Oh,
yeah, you can
awesome.
save it as you go. So if you don't have all of the information when you're initially applying, it will save, and then you can just log back in and fill out the rest. And then once you submit everything, you'll hear a response within 24 business hours on the status of your application.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And just to point out, so if you were to apply over the weekend, obviously, since Growing Generations isn't open on the weekends, if you applied on Friday, you'd hear back from somebody in your department by
On
Monday.
Monday.
Okay, cool. Very cool. So then after that, initial application is turned in and you're chatting with them, kind of what's the next step after that?
So after we review your application, we will kind of evaluate everything. We'll see if we're able to work with you, or if perhaps we need a little bit more information to process everything. So you would either receive an email with some additional questions, or at that point, we'll go ahead and grant you access to schedule a phone consult with one of our specialists, and we'll just kind of walk you through the journey at that point.
Very cool. And like about how long is that consult call?
So the video or the consult call is actually done through
Oh,
video.
awesome.
So that way you will actually get to see the specialist that you'll be working with. Takes about a half hour. And we go over everything that we need to do in order to get your profile up and running for parents to view. What happens once you become matched with intended parents? We discuss the travel and the actual donation process as well.
Very cool. Very cool. Well, let's take a look really quick. We also see, oh, we got Heidi. Hello, Heidi. So yeah, and as we're going through, obviously I'm going to be asking Stephanie some questions, but if you have any specific questions, by all means, go ahead and fill those out. If for some reason, let's say we accidentally skip over your question, we will make sure that after the Facebook Live is done, we'll go back, see if there's any questions that weren't answered, so that way we can go ahead and answer them in the comments. And I'm sure Stephanie can help me with that since, I
Absolutely.
deal with surrogates. Stephanie deals with egg donors, so she knows.
Absolutely.
So very cool. So one of the things I know that for surrogates is there's certain birth control methods that they could use that are, better than others that might kind of either stop the process or we'll have to wait a little bit longer. What's that for egg donors?
So there are three forms of birth control that we would need you to avoid in order to move forward with this process. So the first one is the Depo-Provera shot. It's actually oil-based and would prevent us from moving forward for at least a year after that last shot. We'll also need you to avoid the hormonal IUD, such as the Mirena, that would have to be removed, as well as the implant birth control. So that's the Norplant and Implanon. Those are the ones that go on your arm. But birth control pills, the NuvaRing, the patch, even the non-hormonal or copper IUD are all fine for this process.
Awesome. Very cool. And then if let's say I fill out my application. Well, not me. I'm past the age, which actually let's throw that in really
Me
quick.
too.
So
Me too.
how my kids are gorgeous, but I'm too old. So how old, like for people watching, what's the age demo?
So we accept donors between the ages of 20 years and 29.
Okay.
We remove all active donors from our site on their 31st birthday or after they have completed six donations total.
Okay. Oh wow. So you could do this six times if
Six, up
you
to
want.
six times,
Oh, that's awesome. And is there like a any type of timeline between like one donation to the next, or?
Yeah, so after every donation that you complete, a member of Growing Generations is going to reach out to the clinic that you worked with to obtain the records from your donation. We will update your profile with those results, mm-hmm. and we're also going to have your records reviewed by one of our physicians, just to make sure that you're medically cleared to proceed, mm-hmm. since we don't want to do anything that would jeopardize your health. But as long as you're medically recommended, if returning is something that you would be interested in, mm-hmm. Then you would just need to have two normal periods in between the end of your donation and beginning injectable medications again.
Very cool. That's awesome. Mm-hmm. And then I know like with surrogacy, you have to have been a mom before.
Right.
Not the case with egg donation.
Not the case with egg donation.
Awesome. Very cool. So are there any, like you mentioned the consult call.
Yeah.
So once, you know, the consult call's done and you guys decide that, you know, she'd be a great candidate, yeah. and she's like, oh my gosh, I love Growing Generations. I want to move forward. What would the next step be for her?
Yeah. So after the call, we would send you some documents that we would want you to review, mm-hmm. and sign and send back. This is considered your startup paperwork. We'll also need a couple forms of identification. We'd also like to obtain your college transcripts, since mm-hmm. education is huge for intended parents,
right.
you know, and
mm-hmm.
rightfully so. So after we have that, we're also going to have you create your profile, which entails some essay questions. We would like you to provide some photos, mm-hmm. both recent and childhood, as well as pictures with your family. That's nice. The number one request that we get from intended parents. With our agency, we also have you create an intro video. So the video is just designed to help the parents kind of get a feel of your personality and your mannerisms. Only takes 2 to 3 minutes. Most of our donors have a great time with it.
Mm-hmm.
It really allows them to express themselves a little bit and show the parents what they have to offer.
Nice. Very cool. Very cool. And then if there was any, because I've heard that there's obviously some sort of kind of genetic testing or something called OAR.
Yes.
What's that and when does that happen?
Yeah. So after I have all of your startup paperwork back, mm-hmm. We order a test for you called the OAR, and this is a blood test that would be drawn on a certain day of your period that checks your fertility levels. Typically, those tests would be drawn on day 2, 3, or 4, mm-hmm. 3 being the optimal day.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are using one of those forms of birth control, such as the hormonal IUD, the Mirena, or the Norplant and Implanon, those would need to be removed, and you would have to have 2 normal periods before you could proceed with that testing, since we want to make sure we're getting an accurate reading. If the results were to come back a little wonky, you know, we don't want that to affect your journey. So we want to make sure that we are definitely getting an accurate reading there.
Very cool. And I would think that one of the kind of positives of that testing, and then also later some of the genetic testing, is that's information that would be
Absolutely.
Really valuable for yourself, even
Absolutely.
Not doing, you know, after the egg donation for your own children.
Uh-huh.
That's pretty
yeah.
cool that you just have that already done.
Absolutely.
That's
and,
awesome.
The team that we work with, if, you know, if that's something that you're interested in obtaining as a copy of that, you could just reach out to them directly and they would be happy to provide you with that report for your records.
That's awesome. Very cool. So when it comes to like matching and, you know, like, do you meet the intended parents? Do they?
Have donors that are very open and willing to meeting the intended parents, and if it's something that the intended parents have also expressed interest in, then it's definitely something that we can arrange. In the instance that the parents are interested in meeting and it's something that you're interested in as well, typically the meeting is done through a video conferencing. It is a facilitated meeting so mm-hmm. that, you know, no identifiable
yes.
information is shared.
Right.
Usually takes about a half hour, and we do compensate our donors $250 for their time.
Oh, that's great. Mm-hmm. That's nice. And I see really quickly, I'm looking, we have Danielle and
nice.
Erica. Hello. Hi. And Amanda. Oh, even some of our surrogates are joining. Awesome. Hi. Alicia.
Alicia.
Oh, yeah. Danielle. Nice. Andrea. Oh, lots of our surrogates.
Yeah.
Nice. Hello, Sunny and Lisa.
Hi,
very
ladies.
Cool. And again, if anybody has any questions, you know, feel free to ask that. You know, I did hear before we even get into compensation for mm-hmm. egg donors, because that's always great, mm-hmm. and it's sometimes the reason why some women do this. Let's say you can't be an egg donor. I heard that you guys recently upped your referral fee.
We did. So we're rolling this out today. So the new referral fee for donors, if you refer someone and we are able to work with them, then once they are matched and complete their donation, we will provide you with a referral fee of $1,000. And that goes for every donor that you send our way for their first donation.
Very cool. Yes. Very cool. All of a sudden, I just had this thought back to back when I was in college in my sorority, I'm like, how many women could I have? Smart, educated, right. Attractive women. Right. Nice. And you did mention transcripts. So like, what if somebody, like, I don't know, like, let's say they were like a model or something. And mm-hmm. So maybe they decided to do that before going to college.
Yeah.
Could they still apply, you think?
They can absolutely apply. We look at the bigger picture of everything. So, you know, we're looking at your health history, your family health history. Of course, education is a plus side of things. And right. We would love to be able to, you know, mark your GPA as verified on your profile. Mm-hmm. But definitely, if it's something that you're interested in, fill out the application and we would, you know, be happy to review everything.
Awesome.
Absolutely.
Awesome. So speaking of compensation, yeah. So how does that work with egg donation?
Yes. So as a first-time donor, let me back up a second. So before I can assign you a compensation, we do need to have the results of your OAR testing. So with that, once we have those results, as a first-time donor, you can receive up to $10,000. As a repeat donor for donations 2 through 6, your compensation could be up to $12,000. So upon beginning the injectable medications, mm-hmm. we would send you the first $750, and the remainder comes in the form of a check in the mail within 2 weeks of the retrieval.
Oh, nice. Yeah. And so from, let's say, just timeline-wise,
yeah.
So from, you know, starting the process to, you know, possibly being chosen, or actually, I guess, let me rewind. From starting the process to being actually on the website to where yes. parents could see you, like how long is that, you think?
It's really going to depend on when your period is and when you can complete that OAR testing. Mm-hmm. Typically about a month.
Oh, wow.
But match time really does vary, mm-hmm. Just because every intended parent is looking for something different. So the way I explain it to the donors I work with, we have two sets of parents. So the first set know exactly what they're looking for, whether it's height, ancestry, education, whatever it may be. Mm-hmm. The second set, I refer to it as their aha moment. So when they read their donor's essay questions, they look at her photos and they watch her video, they know that's exactly who they want to work with.
Yeah.
So match time really does vary.
Okay.
With that being said, Growing Generations only accepts 1% of the donors that apply. So if we are moving forward with you, we do feel confident that we would be able to match you. But again, match time would really vary.
Okay. And then once intended parents do choose you, and so, you know, okay, I'm going to be their egg donor. Kind of what's the timeline for that? Like from that to like when you actually have your donation.
With the donation. So you would need to plan anywhere from 2 to 4 months. It just really varies okay. on how quickly you can get in for your psych and medical screening. Mm-hmm. You complete the legal process, how your body is responding to the medications. Mm-hmm. So that really varies. So you really want to plan on roughly 2 to 4 months for the actual donation.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very cool. Very cool. And then travel wise, because you mentioned medical screening, psychological screening. I don't know if there's any other travel that goes with that. What can an egg donor kind of look forward to for that?
Yeah. So at this point, the majority of our intended parents are working in the Southern California area. So if you live anywhere besides Southern California, mm-hmm. you really need to be open to travel. With that, you would be required to travel twice. The first trip would be just a day trip for your screening appointments. Oh, so that would be a psych screening as well as a medical screening. Mm-hmm. And then when it comes time for the retrieval, that would be a 4 to 12 day stay. Now with that, you would need to have a companion with you for your retrieval. Mm-hmm. Now, if your companion can't be with you during the duration of your stay, that's not a problem. We do work with a travel agent, so we can book everything separately. We just want to make sure that, you know, they have someone with you the day of the actual procedure.
Okay.
Reason being, they do place you under a twilight IV sedation for the procedure. That's going to put you at the state right below consciousness so that you don't feel anything.
Oh, nice.
And there's a real good chance you'll be groggy the rest of the day. Mm. So we just want to make sure that, you know, you have someone that can accompany you back to the hotel room and just kind of stay with you that day if you were to need some help.
That's awesome. And obviously, I'm assuming it's just like with surrogacy, where any hotel or flights obviously are paid for.
Absolutely.
And that includes your support person as well.
Yes. With that, the parents fund an account upon selecting you. We would take care of round trip airfare for you and your companion. Mm-hmm. You would share a hotel room. During both of your trips, we would provide you with a daily meal allowance of $75 a day. And we also provide your companion with a $250 meal stipend as well. During that retrieval stay.
Very cool.
Yeah.
And I always think that's so funny when I tell surrogates about that, the $75 a day as well. I'm like, that's more than enough for probably most of us. So that's great. So that's very nice. Mm-hmm. So obviously, you know, you can do a repeat egg donation, like you said. Do you find that sometimes it's for the same family or like totally different families or?
Yeah, in some cases, we have intended parents that come into this knowing they either want a large family or at least a genetic sibling for their child. Mm-hmm. So in some cases, the parents do request that their donor cycle for them again. Of course, like I had mentioned, we would obtain your records first to make sure that you're medically clear to do so. We definitely don't want to do anything that would jeopardize your health. As long as you are cleared to do so and, you know, the clinic has reviewed your records mm-hmm. and they have approved you, then, yeah, we could definitely move forward with another donation.
Awesome. That's very cool. So we'll look really quick. Hello, Heather.
Hi.
Oh, let's see here. Sunny asks, can you be a donor if you have not had a child?
Yes.
Yep, you mm-hmm. mentioned that. Awesome. Very cool. Melanie says, hi. Hello.
Hi.
see some hearts. Yay, thank you. Ooh, Eric asks a good question. Let's see here. Oh, it's the same one. I love it. Yes. And I'm sure you guys get this a lot because especially with surrogates about, you know, the fact that you can be an egg donor, uh-huh. even if you haven't had a child, or even if you don't want a child, I'm assuming not everybody wants kids, I guess. So that'd be a way to help out.
To speak on that, we have a lot of donors that, go on to have families of their own. That is a concern that I get. They go on to have families of their own. And a lot of those women, after they have had their children, mm-hmm. they come back and complete the remaining number of donations that they have allotted to them. As long as it's not surpassing 6 or their 31st birthday.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. Very cool. Let's see here. And we answered Danielle's question. Thank you. Sorry, we didn't see that before about traveling. So that's great. I see Sherry and Lacey. Yay. So speaking of compensation, like I know that like for myself, I have met several, you know, surrogates through this process, and I'm sure you've dealt with just hundreds of egg donors in your years with Growing Generation. Which, how many years have you been?
Five years.
Five years
this
awesome.
Week.
Yeah, that's right. This week. Very cool. So what would you say? Has anybody ever told you kind of what their plans for their compensation was?
You know, a lot of these women, they're in the age range where they're going to school. Mm-hmm. So we've had donors use their compensation to help pay for their college tuition. We've had women use this money to put down payments on their home. Mm-hmm. We even have some donors that have used this money in the philanthropy field. Mm. So, you know, giving back, we have one donor that is just crazy about animals. So she was able to give some money there and, you know, help That's a awesome. Rescue type program.
Very cool. Very cool. One of the things that I have seen is sometimes, a donor might be working with more than one agency. So like, what if they're already with a different agency? What happens then?
Yeah. So Growing Generations, we are not, we don't require that our donor be mutually exclusive to our agency. Okay. So if you are enrolled with another agency, that's not a problem. The only thing that we ask of you is if you become matched with another agency, that you let us know right away so that we can put your profile on hold. Okay. We don't ever want to run into a situation where your profile's on the site. We have parents that fall in love with your profile but unable to move forward with you quickly mm-hmm. because you're involved with another donation.
Right.
Again, we want to make sure that we're obtaining your records to make sure that you're cleared to return and that it's safe for you to do so.
Sounds great. Now, would you say that, like with, again, just the whole working with other agencies or anything like that, you know, what do you think is, like when you think of Growing Generations and egg donation, is there something that you think that you guys do a little better
that stands out
from other people?
You know what, I really find it to be an honor to work for this company. Mm-hmm. Because I know all the hard work that everyone puts into it. I know the care personally. Mm-hmm. That we give all of our donors. Of course, this is a very important journey for the intended parents, but we want your journey to be just as important. You are the reason why these parents are able to have their children. So we want to make sure that you feel appreciated and supported through the entire journey.
That's awesome. Very cool. I'm going to look real quick to make sure we're okay. Let's see here. Somebody coming late to the party. Let's see. Has it already been asked what happens if they already work it out? Oh, yep. We just discussed. Thank you. Great question, because I think that that's another thing that a lot of times when people are thinking surrogacy and egg donation, there are some similarities,
yes,
but there are also some, you know, some differences where, right, you know, with surrogacy, like once you're with us, you're with us.
Right.
But with egg donation, I guess, yeah, when you're waiting to get matched, that makes, uh-huh, sense that you could be. And the other thing too, I think is, you know, you touched on, you know, Growing Generations, you know, really doing a great job, mm-hmm, with egg donors as well. And, you know, it may be that, you know, maybe you have been kind of sitting on a different site for a while, or that you didn't realize that, you know, you didn't necessarily maybe do your research about all the different, you know, possibilities. And who knows, you could probably, you know, it might be that your profile goes up and immediately,
exactly,
you know,
exactly.
I've seen that happen a few times where I've seen an email where I'm like, oh my gosh, they already got chosen. Yeah. Like, that's amazing. That's,
yeah,
so great.
We've had donors selected within a couple days, a couple weeks, a couple months of having their profile up, mm-hmm, on the site. So something that we can always keep in mind, if your profile has been on our site for a few months and we haven't seen a whole lot of traction, mm-hmm, then you could always reach out to one of, you know, your specialists, or your specialist will reach out to you. We can always look at updating your essay questions and your photos, mm-hmm, and your video in hopes of gaining some new views that way.
That's a great idea. Very cool. I saw that Lacey asked a question. She asked, how long are you on the medication?
Yeah, so with the medication, you'll be on that for about 2 weeks. So the injections are given with a subcutaneous needle. If you've ever seen like a diabetic needle or an EpiPen,
yeah,
teeny tiny,
right,
nothing, okay, like the surrogates yet where there is injections. But you'll inject those for about 2 weeks into your lower abdomen or outer thigh. Mm-hmm. Now, while you're taking the injectable medications, they are going to set up monitoring appointments locally to you where you live.
Very cool.
Since you will need to go in a couple times a week for them to check you over, do a little bit of blood work as well as an ultrasound. Mm-hmm. That way your medical team can review those results, and if they need to adjust the medications or the date of your retrieval, they'll be able to keep a real close eye on your progress, and they'll of course keep you in the loop as,
yeah,
well, so that you can,
cool,
get everything lined up for your cycle.
That is awesome. Well, as we, and let me look real quick. Hi, Cassandra. As we are kind of finishing up here a little bit, is there anything maybe that you and I didn't talk about that you think that egg donors should know about, or?
Yeah, honestly, I think we covered everything.
Mm-hmm.
But if anyone out there is interested in egg donation and they have any questions, feel free to reach out to us. You can reach out to me directly. My email address is stephanier@growinggenerations.com. Mm-hmm. If you don't remember that, you can always reach out to our team at eggdonor@growinggenerations.com. Awesome. And we would definitely be happy to, you know, assist you with your journey. That's what we're here for. And we look forward to working with you.
Yeah, and what we'll do is I'll make sure that I'll put Stephanie's email in the comments, so that way if you want to copy and paste, you can do that. Obviously, you know, Stephanie mentioned the Growing Generations website.
Yes.
You know, it's just growinggenerations.com. You'd be click on Be an Egg Donor, and you'll see, you know, if, let's say after this, you're like, oh my gosh, I forgot everything she said. It's okay. It's all on the website. Even in a whole section, including frequently asked questions. So it would go through all the different things. There's also a resource section on there, which has blogs specifically for women who want to be egg donors, that kind of go over what Stephanie,
yeah,
told us, and also some other things that are just kind of random that we thought maybe you would be interested in knowing a little bit more about.
And a medical video.
Yeah, there's videos in there. And I'm just going to look one last time, because I always hate if I end this before somebody had a question, but it looks good. So, you know, if you do know somebody who, you know, whether it's yourself who wants to be an egg donor, if you know somebody who you think would be a great egg donor, or who might be open to it, you know, feel free to mention it, because not only would you be helping someone create a family, because like Stephanie said,
that's an important thing.
Yeah, without the help of egg donors, some families would never be able to have a child, you know, and So it's really important. But the other thing is with the new referral fee, it's also win-win. Yes. Because not only are you helping create a family, but you also are going to be compensated for referring, you know, women that you think would be amazing egg donors to Growing Generations. So, you know, you can, you know, take a look, you know, send them our way if you're excited. I even had a friend from high school where her daughter has just graduated college and is adorable and smart and funny and athletic. And I was like, you know, she'd probably be a good egg donor. And so she told her all about it and she applied. So we'll see how that goes. But, you know, just, you know, keep in mind, although it is funny with the referrals, I will say that now when I walk down the street, if I see women, you know, of a certain age who I think are, you know, very pretty or have like really, you know, like really neat eyes or whatever, I'm thinking egg donor. So now, now with the referral, I might be the one approaching people like, have you ever thought about it? Yeah, exactly. Well, very cool. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us. This will be available. It'll be posted on our website. We'll also move this over to our YouTube channel as well. You know, if you don't know very much about egg donation, it's fine. You can just share this video. Feel free to share it on your own page. You could share it through messaging if you think that people don't, you know, I guess some people are open about being egg donors. Some aren't. So,
and you know what? It's, if you're not, that's fine. We just want to make sure that you have a support system behind you, you know, to help you through this process.
Perfect. Well, awesome. Well, thank you so much for having me today.
Thanks.
It's awesome. So have a great time. And hey, we're almost to the weekend, so have a great weekend. If anybody's bored over the weekend and they want to take a look at be an egg donor on Growing Generation, then, hey, I can think of a better way to spend a Sunday.
Right.
So anyway, have a good one. Bye, guys.
See you later.